made this declaration in Acts chapter 2 verse 36, that let all the house of Israel therefore know assuredly that God hath made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom ye crucified. He was making an official announcement to all those in heaven, on the earth, and under the earth, that there had been a change in kingship and headship of the kingdom of God from God the Father to God the Son. Cherished listeners, welcome to the Oracles of God radio broadcast, a biblical program that is run and sponsored by the Churches of Christ, which come your way every Wednesday 5:30 a.m. on Radio Universe 105.7 FM. Shall we go to God in prayer? Oh, the most blessed Jehovah God Almighty, the uncreated Creator, the unseen omniscient God, we bow in awe of your greatness. We thank you for yet another wonderful and beautiful day you've ushered us into. Thank you for counting us among the living players. It is never but our might or righteousness, but because of immeasurable grace and love towards us, please forgive us of all our sins we committed against you and mankind in any form. We beseech you, O Lord, to take us on control by today's program to successful end. Grant our listeners a devout heart that would understand and respond to your priceless oracles as you speak through us. We once again entrust the entire staff of Radio Universe, as well as all our cherished listeners, into your hands throughout this day and the days to come. Grant the Radio Universe technician the technical know-how to be able to transmit your oracles unadulterated to your children so as to be saved. Begin the next successful with us in the name above all names, Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Cherished listeners, we continue with a series of lessons we enjoy from the theme Eschatology, the study of God's judgment. We're still on the exposition of selected misconstrued texts of the 144,000 people mentioned in Revelation chapter 7 and 14. And the text we're discussing is Luke chapter 12 and 32, which reads as follows. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. We are on the second part of the text with the topic Kingdom of God. Cherished listeners, last week we learned how Jesus prepared the nation of Israel for a change in the kingship and headship of the kingdom of God, and learned the following: that the Father was both king of the Israelite kingdom and king of the universal kingdom. That is why Jesus made statements to the Jews such as the following, and I quote, "The kingdom of God is within you," unquote. Luke chapter 20 verse 21. It was within those who had submitted to the kingdom reign of the Father from heaven. The sovereignty of the kingdom of the Father, we learned, was manifested when the will of the Father ruled in the hearts of men as it ruled in heaven. That is why in Matthew chapter 6 verse 10, Jesus taught, quote, "Your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as it is in heaven," unquote. In other words, the kingdom of God comes when God's will is done on earth in the hearts of men, as it is done in heaven. When men submit to the sovereignty of deity in their hearts, then the kingdom of God is within them. Again, we did learn last week that throughout Jesus' ministry, he told the Jews that the authority of the sovereignty of the Father was being passed to him. Quote, "All things," he proclaimed, "have been delivered to me by my Father," unquote. Matthew chapter 11, verse 27. "The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hands," unquote. John chapter 3 and verse 35. Cherished listeners, that Jesus prepared the minds of his audience concerning the transition from the Israelite kingdom to the church. For instance, in Matthew 21, for the prayer we learned, that Jesus said, "Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof." Jesus here talks about his coming kingdom relationship with man, which Peter refers to as a holy priesthood or a holy nation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 and 9. In Exodus chapter 19, verse 5 and 6, we do remember that it is stated that the nation of Israel was God's holy nation and a holy priesthood in the Old Testament times. However, after the establishment of the church, the Father considered the church a holy nation and a holy priesthood. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 and 9. We did also learn last week that Jesus also gave a visual evidence of the coming of that kingdom. A visual evidence of the coming of that kingdom. In Mark chapter 9, verse 1. In Mark chapter 9, verse 1, Jesus said, good, it will come with power. The kingdom will come with power. The apostles, after Jesus' resurrection and ascension, were to wait in Jerusalem until they were endued with power from on high. Luke 24:49. Luke 24:49. Jesus promised the apostles, quote, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. So power links with kingdom. The kingdom would come with power. And he said, wait in Jerusalem for the power. So in effect, the kingdom was supposed to come. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. When the power came, therefore, in Acts chapter 2, the apostles knew that the kingdom of God had come. Cherished listeners, we also learned last week that Jesus indicated the generation time in which that kingdom will come. Not only the visual evidence of power, he even gave a signal of the time, the generation in which that kingdom was supposed to come. And that was in the lifetime of some of his listeners at the time he was speaking, as he said in Mark chapter 9, verse 1. In Mark chapter 9, verse 1, this is what Jesus said. And he said unto them, verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here, which shall not taste of death, till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. Unquote. So Jesus was very specific regarding the generation in which the kingdom was supposed to come. As some still wait for the kingdom that Jesus promised to come, the Bible is saying the kingdom had come long time ago, 2,000 years ago. For Jesus promised his people that apart from coming with power, that it happened in Acts chapter 2, he did also say that those standing there will not taste death, some of them, and they will see the kingdom of God come with power. And you bear me out that all those people are dead now. So if the kingdom hadn't come, then are we saying that Jesus deceived them? God forbid. For the kingdom had come. In Acts chapter 2, it came with power, as we read in the scriptures. Cherishedness, today we continue with the kingship and headship of the Son. Now we are talking on the transfer, handing over of the authority to Jesus, the Son. And we want to now look into details what it means. Cherishedness, Jesus is now king and head with sovereignty over all things. After the ascension, the Father delivered to the Son all authority over all things. The extent of the Son's sovereignty is magnified in the New Testament by the extent of the Father's sovereignty before the ascension. Jesus is not coming again in the future to establish more power and authority over everything than he presently has. He presently has all authority that was prophesied in the Old Testament. If he presently has all kingship authority that was prophesied, then he cannot be coming to assume more in order to fulfill the Old Testament prophecies concerning his reign. It is our belief that a failure to see the extent of the Son's sovereignty in this present age has laid an unfortunate foundation for the false concept of the 1,000-year reign of Jesus when he comes again. Some biblical interpreters have failed to see the universal extent of Jesus' sovereignty as portrayed in the prophecies of the prophets. Others have limited the sovereignty of Jesus to the church alone in this age. Pre-millennialists recognize the universal sovereignty of Jesus as prophesied in the prophets. At the same time, they recognize the limited view some have in the present reign of Jesus. Their false conclusion was thus inevitable. Since it was taught that Jesus did not have universal sovereignty at this time, as prophesied in the prophets, he must receive it yet in the future. However, when we understand the extent of Jesus' sovereignty in this age, we can clearly understand that he will not receive more in the future. If he has all authority at this present time, then he cannot receive more authority in the future. The following thought of this lesson emphasizes the extent to which Jesus is presently reigning over all things in heaven and earth. This reign will continue until the final coming. At that time, Jesus will return all sovereignty to God, who gave it all to him. Cherished listeners, let us rejoice that presently Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords over all, in heaven, on the earth, and under the earth. Jesus the Son has universal kingdom presently. When he died and resurrected and ascended to God, he was given all authority. In Acts chapter 1, as it is recorded. Then in Acts chapter 2, there was an official announcement that is what has happened. So Israel by faith, people of Israel who believed in the Messiah and obeyed the gospel, were baptized into the kingdom in the church. Then we the Gentiles also who heard the gospel by faith also repented and were baptized and added into the kingdom in the church. So this will continue until the final coming. The picture is beautiful. Jesus the Son is King of Kings presently, having authority over all. However, there are those obedient subjects, Israel by faith and Gentiles of faith, that have together come and have humbled themselves under the authority of Jesus to obey him, have been baptized and added to his church. So the kingdom in the church, outside, we have disobedient subjects. The picture has it that if only those who be saved are found in the church. Even though Jesus' kingdom extends even to include disobedient subjects, it is only those who are found in the church, in the kingdom, that will be saved. So, that is how the picture looks like. All authority is with Jesus. Israel by faith and Gentiles of faith are in the kingdom, in the church. Outside, we have disobedient subjects, all together under the universal kingdom of the Son. This will continue until the final coming, when he hands over to the Father. Let us take it one by one, seriousness. We want to look at the following of Jesus. His authority, his rule, his headship, his kingship, and his reign. The authority of Jesus, his rule, his headship, his kingship, and his reign. Let's begin with the authority of Jesus over all things. One must clearly see the Son now in a position where the Father has abdicated all authority to him. After his resurrection and before his ascension, Jesus said, quote, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth," unquote. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. This is the message that he proclaimed to the Jews throughout his earthly ministry. Matthew chapter 11, verse 27, John chapter 13, verse 3, and John chapter 17, verse 2. He possessed all authority and prospered during his early ministry. After his ascension, he activated all authority when he ascended to the throne of David in heaven. Jesus' galactic sovereignty was brought into activation when he ascended to the throne in heaven. This is the message the New Testament now proclaims of his present position. Peter stated that Jesus is both Lord and Christ. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 36. In Acts chapter 10 verse 36, Peter stated, "He is Lord of all. Jesus is over all." Romans chapter 9 verse 5. He cannot have more authority and power in the future than all the authority and power that he has been given, which he now has. When one authority understands the measure and extent of his present authority, then he can understand that a preliminary theory of a 1,000-year reign that Jesus will come and reign, that he will supposedly receive more authority when he comes in the future, cannot be true. In fact, in comparison to the extent of Jesus' authority now, he will be brought down from his present position in the future if he was to come and reign upon this physical earth. His authority is over the universe at this time. Any reign on this earth will be less than universal authority over all things that have been created. That is about the authority of Jesus. Now let's look at the rule of Jesus over all things. The rule. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, God showed Daniel that because a kingdom was given to the Son of Man, who ascended unto him, all peoples and nations should serve him. Should serve him. Philippians chapter 2, verse 8 to 11, uses this same subjunctive mood to express the thought that all should bow down to Jesus in this present age. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 8 to 11, it is stated that God has highly exalted Jesus. Quote, "At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow," unquote. That's verse 10. This would include things in the spirit world and the physical world. Quote, "Every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord," unquote. That is verse 11. Satan, demons, angels, kings and lords should confess the present kingship of Jesus. The fact that they do not do so currently does not mean that Jesus is not their Lord and King. The fact that they do not confess Jesus as King and Lord only manifests that they are insubordinate subjects of his kingdom. Jesus is ruling over all powers. This would include Satan. He is ruling over them whether they desire it or not. He rules, quote, "with a rod of iron," unquote. The rod of iron wasn't mentioned for nothing. The rod of iron means that some will be disobedient, but he will rule them by force, whether they like it or not. That is why Revelation chapter 2, verse 26 and 27 uses the metaphor, the rod of iron. Revelation chapter 11, verse 15 also reads, Revelation 11, 15 reads, quote, "The kingdom of this world have become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever," unquote. Remember that we said that irrespective of who is on the throne, the God, the Lordship, the deity, the Godship remains the same. Irrespective of who is on the throne, God is God. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit idea of God's manifestation remains the same. So, the Bible is saying that the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And good. When Jesus ascended to assume kingship at the right hand of the Father. The Father gave all authority to him in order that he rule over all things. All things are put in subjection under Jesus. In Psalm 8, verse 6, David made a statement in relation to God placing man in dominion over all things of this earth. This statement is quoted by a Hebrew writer in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 6 to 8, and applied to the present reign and authority of Jesus over all things. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 8, it states, quote, "You have put all things in subject under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him." Unquote. The phrase "all things" is all inclusive. Everything has been put under Jesus' feet. He has authority over all. Nothing has been left out. We look in the world and we do not actually see everything working in subjection to him. We see only the church in subjection to Jesus. However, because we do not see men living in subjection to Jesus, does not mean that he's not reigning over them. When Jesus comes again, he will submit all things to the power of his might. He will do such in the twinkle of an eye at the last trumpet. Of Jesus, Peter wrote, quote, "Who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him," unquote. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 22. The kingship of Jesus is over all things. His kingdom encompasses Satan, demons, world governments, angels, the church, and the physical world, for he upholds the physical world by the word of his power. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 3. Cherished listeners, we must emphasize the fact that because we do not yet see everything presently submitted to Jesus, that this means he is not king and Lord of all. Only the church is the visible manifestation of the kingdom reign of Jesus. Christians are those who are in a submitted relationship with Jesus as their head. All disobedient subjects do not manifest their submission. Nevertheless, they are subject to his rule. So regarding Jesus' rule, he rules over all. Now let's move on to the third, the headship of Jesus over all things. The headship of Jesus over all things. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20 to 23, we read, stresses the universal headship of Jesus over all creation. As the Father was head over all things before the ascension, Ephesians 1, 20-23 stresses the headship of Jesus over all things after the ascension. Ephesians 1, verse 20-23 teaches that when Jesus was resurrected and ascended to the ancient of days, the Father set him far above the physical world and spiritual world. Jesus was given authority above every name or authority. The Father put all things under his feet. As the Father was head over all things before the ascension, so the Son is now head over all things. Jesus is the head of Satan and his demons. He is the head of all world governments. He is a universal head to the church. In other words, he is a universal head over all authorities for the sake or benefit of the church. This brings great encouragement to Christians. We know that regardless of what happens in the world, Jesus is in control. Though we may not see his control, we know that he is in control through the revelation of his word. We thus walk by faith and not by sight. So with the headship of Jesus, Jesus is the head of all things for the sake of the church. Four, the kingship of Jesus over all things. The kingship of Jesus over all things. Jesus is now king over a universal kingdom. That includes all world governments, all people, all angels, the disembodiment of the world, the disobedience, and the church. He is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Jesus is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 15. He is the ruler over the kings of the earth. The ruler over the kings of the earth. Revelation chapter 1 verse 5. John wrote that he is Lord of lords and King of kings. Revelation chapter 17 and verse 14. And also Revelation chapter 19 and verse 16. Cherished listeners, setting the statement Lord of lords and King of kings will make no sense if Jesus was king only of a church kingdom or Lord only over the submitted. His kingship and lordship must extend beyond the church, simply because passages as 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 15 and Revelation chapter 17 verse 14 clearly state such. What a wonderful king we have. Then the final one, the fifth one, is the reign of Jesus over all things. The reign of Jesus over all things. The Bible teaches that Jesus is presently reigning. There are several key passages that affirm his universal reign. The thought of these key passages explains the totality of Jesus' kingdom reign. It is hard to understand these scriptures if one has a view that Jesus' kingship and lordship are limited to the church. The first passage is 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 22. 1 Peter 3, 22, Peter stated concerning Jesus, quote, who Christ has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers have been made subject to him, unquote. All angels, authorities, and powers are subject to the present rule of Christ. This passage is not discussing future events. It is discussing the present reign of Jesus. Though the angels and authorities of this passage are not in the church, they are still under the reign of Jesus. Therefore, all who are in the church are in the kingdom reign of Jesus. But not all that are under the kingdom reign of Jesus are in the church. 2. Revelation chapter 1 verse 5. John stated that Jesus is the ruler over the kings of the earth. This passage states that Jesus is now reigning over all kings of the earth. This is a present reign of Jesus. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. 1 Timothy 6:15, Revelation 17:14. This passage is also in the present tense. Therefore, Jesus was reigning at the time John made this statement, and he is still reigning. Passage 3, Revelation chapter 12, verse 5. In this context, John sees a vision which portrays the birth of Jesus. The vision speaks of Jesus' birth and ascension to the right hand of God, where Jesus was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. He is now on the throne of authority over all nations. Revelation chapter 19, verse 15. He now rules with divine authority. Passage 4. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. Paul wrote, quote, for if we die with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. Unquote. Christians died with Jesus when they were crucified with him on the cross of repentance. They were buried with him and resurrected through obedience to the gospel. Romans 6, 3-6. They have thus been crucified with Christ. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Therefore, Christians are presently enduring with Jesus in the hardships of this life. Here is the point of Paul's statement in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. If Christians presently endure with Jesus, they are presently reigning with him. Paul says that we reign in life. Romans chapter 5, verse 17. Christians reign in life with Jesus who is presently reigning in heaven. In fact, Christians reign in life because Jesus is reigning. If Jesus was not now on David's throne and reigning, then Christians would not be reigning. There are kings and lords of this earth, seriousness. Jesus is their king and lord. One must understand that the church is only one part of Jesus' kingly reign. He is the king of all those in the church. He reigns over the church. And it is only those in the church that will be saved. All those after the church are disobedient subjects of the kingdom of Jesus. That is why we say in the Harover, he is king of those in the church because he is the king of all things. He does reign over the church. However, Jesus is reign over the church because he's reign over all things. The church is defined as the assembly of those who have been called by the gospel out of the world of disobedient subjects. The kingdom of God is within the Christian simply because the Christian allows the will of the Father to be done on earth in his heart as it is done in heaven. The church is the submitted subject of the universal sovereignty of Jesus. Oh, church listeners, if this is the case, why do you therefore tarry? Why don't you become a part of the church that Christ purchased with his own blood? Because it is only those in that church that are obedient subjects to the universal kingdom of Christ. Outside are disobedient ones that will be punished if they don't repent. So flee from the flock of the disobedient and join the obedient ones in his church. And that is exactly what God is telling you this morning. That he is crying aloud, wherever you are, flee from this crooked and perverse generation and join. Let Christ add you to his church. Because it is only in the church that those who have submitted to his mercy, it is only in the church that they can say, Christ's kingdom has come. Because the kingdom of God is within the obedient, submitted ones. When the will of God is done in the hearts of the Christian, then his kingdom has come. And that is exactly what the Bible is telling all of us. We should therefore be very serious about this and ensure that we've understood the purpose of Christ in our lives. This day we've looked at, in detail, what Jesus is currently doing. We have looked at the authority of Jesus, and we are saying Jesus' authority is over all things. That is what the Bible says. We will look at the rule of Jesus, and he says currently Jesus is ruling over all things. We have looked at the headship of Jesus. We say Jesus is the head over all things for the sake of the church. We have looked at the kingship of Jesus, and we say he is the king of kings over all things. We look at the reign of Jesus, and we say the Bible is saying the reign is reigning over all things. We look at some passages, and they are pointing to the fact that Jesus is currently ruling. He's not going to receive any higher authority in the end than what he's earning now. Don't get disappointed. Be in his kingdom, be in his church, and be among the obedient ones. Let his kingdom be in your hands. For the will of the Father is done in the heart of the obedient servant of Jesus' kingdom. May you be part of this wonderful. It is only and only that time that will receive all the immeasurable blessings of the kingdom. The blessings of the kingdom go to only those who have submitted to him. And that is why we are saying that the church had a wonderful blessing. Because it contains only those who have submitted to the Lordship of Jesus. God willing, next week, we shall continue, make a time with that same time, God willing, once again. This has been the Oracles of God Radio Broadcast, a biblical program that is run and sponsored by the Churches of Christ, which comes your way every Wednesday, 5:30 a.m. Make a day with that same time, God willing, next week, as God continues to arrive in his ministries, and usher us into his precious oracles. You may want to call us on 024-552-7658, or send us a message on coc.radio@yahoo.com. This has been your brother, Eric Darko. Now may the Lord Almighty God bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and give us peace now and forevermore. So we'll meet again. Stay blessed in Jesus' name. Amen and good morning.